So, this year I read five terrible books. That's a lot of terrible books. Five terrible books already in 2021. It's not looking good. So, I want to set the record straight. What have I seen in these five terrible books? Technically speaking, I've read a lot of other terrible books before in my life, but 2021, you get the point. I want to tell you actually what I think makes a terrible book. And I want you to go down in the comments below because, again, I don't want to make this just about me. What makes a terrible book? The first point is that the author is convinced of their greatness. At this point out there, there are so many resources telling you how to write a better book. But a lot of people don't look at those, and if they do, they look at it as if they have already done those things. What makes a terrible book is the author. And I think what makes a terrible author at its heart is that the author is cocky and they think they're hot shit and they think that they're great. If you honestly think that you have done all the good things there is to do and that a book is technically without any flaws, you at its heart are fundamentally just not going to write a good book. It is especially given when you write a second book or a third book in a trilogy or in your career and you are still making the same mistakes from before. And so at its heart, what makes a terrible book? This is what makes it in my eyes. It's that the author is cocky and they are convinced of their greatness. And then there is cancel culture. Isn't that a weird transition? That's the weirdest transition. But the reason why this has to do a lot with cancel culture is primarily because, guess what? If you are going to be writing a book and then you are trying to write about a topic with which you have no experience with, in other words, it didn't have a personal impact on you have to make sure you do the due diligence and you have to go out there and do the research. It's simple as that. It's really simple as that. If you are going to write about a sensitive topic, you have to write about that topic with competence, at least competence, at least, right? Not necessarily comprehensive understanding, but with some competency. And I think a lot of authors out there who write about sensitive topics and call themselves, I'm not like other authors. I have all of these, sensitive topics, right? And all of these controversial things. Well, they are justifying the existence of cancel culture. They are justifying specifically the existence of cancel culture within books, within the book communities out there, because every week or two, there is a new author that is getting canceled and bombarded. And 99% of the time, the criticism that is lauded at these authors, that is thrown at these authors, it's valid because they are trying to cover something sensitive, something that is not necessarily common in society. And they don't do the research. They don't talk to people who have had these experiences. They don't look up resources. They don't buy books by those authors. Biographies is what I'm trying to get to. And technically speaking, you have to do the due diligence required in order to cover and to research about a sensitive topic properly. And lack of this in a book, to me, it's going to be terrible. And then there is the Terry Goodkind syndrome. I call it the Terry Goodkind syndrome because the author in this particular case is convinced that the take on a cliche is unique. And I call this the Terry Goodkind syndrome because the author in this particular book is convinced that the book is not cliched and that the take on a cliche is unique. Because Terry Goodkind has claimed out there hundreds of times that he doesn't just write fantasy, he doesn't just write people, and he writes unique characters in unique worlds. And technically speaking, I call BS on that. I read The Wizard's First Rule, and I tried Stone of Tears, the second book. Well, guess what? They are both full of cliches, but here's what I'm talking about. He thinks and he's convinced that his take on these cliches, the chosen one, the mentor, the crazy dark lord, his take, in other words, on fantasy tropes is unique, but it is the most tropic fantasy book I have ever read. If you as an author have tropes in your story and you think your take on those tropes are unique without actually doing the reading and looking into the genre and reading the genre with which you are writing, and then technically not realizing that your take on those cliches is actually super cliched and it's terrible, then to me you're a terrible author and your book is a terrible book. Simple as that. Don't be Terry Goodkind, basically. And then there is the lack of a spark. I don't know what I mean by this, but I can explain it with a feeling, okay? Because I remember the last time I explained this to a friend of mine, I used The Way of Kings by Brandon Sanderson and how in the world of Rosha, technically the world is alive, the unclaimed hills. In there, there's a lot of grass, and the grass, you know, pulls back into the land if it feels threatened. And so the moment the wagon approaches, the grass goes down, it pulls back into the ground. And it then, once the wagon moves away, the grass comes back. And so without clearing the road, the grass clears itself. Do you see what I'm talking about? This is a spark. The world of Roshar is a living world. Okay, and that is the crutch, that is the main thesis of this world. This is what I think makes me very interested in this world, because I'm like, everything in here is alive, okay? Even the trees. So that is what makes it super, super unique and super interesting. And that is what I call the spark. And a lot of books don't have the spark. They feel like another book. Let's take a fantasy book. They feel like another fantasy book. If you take a mystery book, they feel like another mystery book. There's nothing to it. It's like, you know, watching the first Justice League movie with Joss Whedon and then watching Zack Snyder's cut of the Justice League. There's just difference, right? And the spark is basically something that ignites my passion for your story. If you don't have that, likely I might DNF, or I will be extremely bored, or you have to be very good at writing a plot. And writing a good plot is actually extremely difficult. The characters. There are two things I believe, genuinely speaking, that make a good character. And these two are actually exemplified in one of my two favorite fantasy authors. And it's that A, Brandon Sanderson, the characters are well tested, okay? So if you have a character and you don't test your characters well, guess what? You have failed in my eyes as an author, because that character is going to be boring. And so it's fine to not have a flawed character. In other words, it's fine to have a perfect angel. You just have to test them as well as Brandon Sanderson does with a lot of his protagonists. Now let's take the other author, George R. R. Martin. Well, if you're not going to test your characters, you have to have a flaw with them that makes them interesting. So it's these two things, either a test that makes your characters struggle and the struggle itself is interesting, or you have a flaw with your character and that flaw makes your characters interesting, okay? And so a lot of terrible books don't do this. They have flat characters that are not tested. What the heck? You have a character that has no flaw and you don't bother testing this character. It's like Twilight. You have to have characters that are well tested or flawed. And if you really want to be an epic author who is complete, have flawed characters that are well tested. Simple. And so that's going to be all the things I think make a terrible book. I want to hear what you think down in the comments below, and what you think makes a terrible book. I hope you took something from this. Have a nice day.